Hi, I'm Jen Wilkin, and I want to invite you to join me for a study that I've just finished on the Sermon on the Mount. The Sermon on the Mount is Jesus' longest recorded message, and we find it at the beginning of the Gospel of Matthew, and it happens at the beginning of his ministry. So often we hear the Sermon on the Mount taught in pieces as lessons that stand in their own right on worry, or on how we ought to pray, or on how we ought to give. But what we're going to do in this study is have a chance to see the Sermon on the Mount as one cohesive unit that starts somewhere deliberate and builds to a deliberate point. And in it, he unfolds for us what it looks like to be a citizen of his kingdom, a citizen of the kingdom of heaven in which he is the king. I'm looking forward to being with you for this 9-week study of the Sermon on the Mount.
Good morning, church. It's so great just to be in the Lord's house with God's people and be able to worship him and be challenged and encouraged by his word. If you're a guest with us today, I just encourage you to grab one of these connection cards in the back of your pew, just so we can have a record of your visit, and we would love to just get in touch with you and get to know you a little bit better. So a lot of important announcements this morning. That women's Bible study is starting September 22nd, going to October 17th. And then there's a concurrent one starting September 17th and going through November 12th. And one has childcare and the other one doesn't. So please check that study out. There are books available for purchase for $15 down here in the fellowship hall. And there's also a women's Bible study that started back in the spring before COVID hit. I think it was going through the book of Hebrews. So if you were a part of that study, they're finally going to have their last session. That's going to be September 15th, 9:30 in the Activity Center. So if you're part of that study, they're going to wrap that up. Of course, we have three ways to worship here at FBC Carlsbad. In person, 8:15 and 10:45. You can also worship online. The 10:45 service is when that goes live. And then there's a week delayed version on the radio at KATK 92.1 FM at 9 a.m. Three ways to give. At the back of every exit and at the Welcome Center, there are those wooden boxes for your tithes and gifts and offerings. You can also mail your offering into the church or give online. So this is exciting. We're finally able to have Sunday school again. So next week, 9:30, September 20th, Sunday school is starting back, which is great news. If you have questions about that, you can call the church office. Or if you're wondering how we're dealing with COVID or the regulations there, you can check out the church website, and there's some information about that. This was an idea from a church member, but during this time where our kids aren't going to school in person, we want to be able to meet some of those needs. We just know that being in isolation, kids' anxiety is going up. We're seeing suicide rates and depression and things like that skyrocket. And as a church, we want to meet that. We want to engage these students. And so if we can get the volunteers, we would like to make an after-school type study hall program happen. This would look like opening the activity center first to church families and then hopefully to everyone, just to bring their kids up where they can get some social interaction, hang out with their friends in a safe environment, socially distanced, and get help with their school and tutoring. So if you are a retired teacher, if you're great at math or English or something like that, we need your help. We need volunteers to make this thing happen. So please come see me if you can see yourself helping with that, whether just being a chaperone or helping tutoring in a specific subject. That'll probably be on Wednesdays, potentially from 3 to 5. Today is Service Opportunity Sunday. We have set up booths and have people out in the fellowship hall. When service is over, everyone can go out through this door. And we're just encouraging you to walk through that room, look at the different ministries we have, you know, the tech team, youth, children, adult ministries, all the different ministries that we do here. We need volunteers to help in those. So we would just encourage everyone to take a look at that. We've also brought in someone where you can register to vote if you haven't done that. There's a table. You can register to vote, and you can also get counted for the census. I don't know if you know this, but the census is a big deal. Like, that affects funding for 10 years at a time. So if you haven't got counted in the census, that's very important for your community. So please go to the fellowship hall and do that. Mission New Mexico offering. We've raised about $375. Our goal is $5,000 this year. So I would just encourage you to think about how we can reach our neighbors, our own backyard, and not just overseas, but think about giving to that offering. Also exciting, we have a baptism this morning, so please direct your attention to the screens as we introduce the baptism.
Today,
I tell my friends,
my family,
the world,
that the old Adam,
the old Jimmy,
the old Crystal is dead. I have been buried with Christ.
My sin is gone, nailed to the cross,
and paid for
by the blood of
my Savior,
of my Jesus. Today, I declare
that by God's relentless,
unfailing grace,
I am forgiven.
I am free.
I am new.
Good morning, First Baptist Carlsbad family. It is good to be in the house of the Lord this morning, and always a blessing to be able to begin a service with baptism. This is Todd Hayden. A couple weeks ago, he came forward to share that he had already trusted Jesus Christ as his Savior and Lord, but never took that very first step of obedience in the Christian life, and that's to follow Jesus in believer's baptism. And so he's coming this morning, wanted to take that step, really to preach a sermon through the baptismal waters, that he is standing for Jesus Christ today. And I'm going to ask him that same question I ask everyone as they come into these baptismal waters. Do you publicly profess Jesus Christ to be your personal Savior and Lord?
Yes, I do.
Well, based upon your public profession of faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, and in obedience to his command, I now baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, buried with Christ in death, raised to walk in newness of life. All God's people said, Amen. Amen. This is a day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Would you join me as we ask His blessings upon our time of worship this morning? Father God, we do thank you for the salvation that you bring in and through your Son, Jesus Christ, by grace alone, through faith alone. And Father, I thank you for the opportunity this morning to begin this service with baptism, publicly show and demonstrate outwardly the inward change that has been taking place in Todd's life. Father, I thank you for that transformation. I thank you for the Spirit that you have placed in each and every one of your children. And Father, I thank you for that Spirit that allows us to come to worship in spirit and in truth this morning, to worship freely in this place. Father, I thank you for each and every person that you have drawn here today to be a part of this worship experience, either in person or online. Father, I pray that we would hear from you and that we would leave different change because we have been in your presence. Might all that we say and all that we do truly honor and glorify you. We ask all this in Jesus' precious name and for his sake. Amen.
Amen. Well, good morning, church. It is good to see you as we met together in the house of the Lord to praise Him. I just got a text from my wife, Amy. She is a part of a disaster relief team that is, they're on their way to Louisiana this morning to assist the folks who've been affected by the hurricane there. And she texted me and she says, we are watching on Facebook as they're driving down the highway this morning. So we welcome those who are worshiping with us online this morning as well. But we're glad that you're here. Let's stand together and bless the name of the Lord this morning.
Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name. What about Blessed be your name, with sun shining down on me, with the world all as it should be. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name, on the road marked with suffering, with pain in the offering. Blessed be your name. Blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will stay. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Oh, blessed be the name. Blessed be your name. You give and take away. You give and take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name.
Bless the name of the Lord this morning and to worship and give him praise.
Blessing to my heart to sing thy grace, streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet sung by flaming tongues above. Raise the mount I fixed upon. Till you came and rescued me, I was
do welcome you into this place today. And we say, we come, Lord Jesus, and be in our midst today. Lord, we thank you that you inhabit the praise of your people. And so, Lord, we want to be sensitive to your leadership today and your presence here in this place. God, we know that you have promised never to leave us or forsake us, and we thank you for that assurance. We thank you that you are the same yesterday, today, and forever, and that your mercies are new every morning. God, we recognize that in our spiritual walk, sometimes when we don't sense you near us, it is not you that has moved, but it is us who have moved away from you. So I pray this morning, Lord, if there's something in our life that would impede our worship, that would hinder our relationship with you, God, that you would help us to be convicted of that, to confess it to you and to ask for forgiveness and to repent of that, a sin that might be a stumbling block that keeps us from hearing from you. And so, Lord, we thank you this morning for your presence with us, for the abiding presence of your Holy Spirit as believers, that we have you to indwell us, that we have you to guide us, to direct us, to convict us of sin, to encourage us, to meet every need of our life. And God, we thank you for that and just for your presence. And so this morning, Lord, may our hearts be in tune with you, and may we sing of your praise. And may our praise be acceptable in your ear this morning. God, in just a few moments as we look to your word, we pray that you would give us open hearts and open ears to what you would have to say to us. And God, that we might respond to you in faith and obedience, that we would make the necessary changes in our lives to follow you for where you are working. Thank you for the opportunities we have to be of service to you, to be working in your kingdom. Thank you for the spiritual gifts and talents and abilities that you give us to be able to serve you. And Lord, may we dedicate ourselves afresh and anew as living sacrifices, holy and acceptable to you, which is our reasonable act of worship. God, we just pray that you'll meet with us today and that you'll be honored and magnified in this place. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Who are we that you would be mindful of us? What do you see that's worth looking our way? We are free in ways that we never should. such a tiny offering compared to Calvary. Nevertheless, we lay it at your feet. All that is within me cries for you.
glorious day. If you can't get excited about that, I'm not sure what you can get excited about. Man, that day getting sooner and sooner. Today is sooner than it was yesterday. If we get to tomorrow, tomorrow's going to be sooner yet still than it is today. God came in the form of Jesus Christ, Emmanuel, God with us, to put away sin the first time. Second time, he's coming back for his bride, the church, and that day is getting sooner and sooner. We see the signs all around us. We see yet another Arab country making peace with Israel. But we see also signs in the heavens and signs here on earth with earthquakes and fires and floods and all kinds of things happening. Folks, it's getting sooner and sooner by the day. But until that day comes, and a glorious day it will be, until that day comes, there is work yet to do in proclaiming the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. If you have your copy of God's Word, I invite you to go ahead and be turning to the book of Nehemiah in the Old Testament, Nehemiah chapter 7. We are actually going to get through all of chapter 7 today. For those of you that are skeptical, or what, if you're with us on Sunday nights and Wednesday nights, particularly Sunday nights, I don't get very far. And tonight in Philippians, we start chapter 3. I'm probably going to get through one verse of Philippians. But it's about rejoicing, and we can rejoice all the time in the Lord. But I promise you today, we're going to get through all of chapter 7. I may not read all of chapter 7. You can go back and read some of the names later on, but we'll get through all of chapter 7 in Nehemiah today. You know, 2 days ago was the 19th anniversary of another day that will live in infamy for this generation, 9/11/2001, and 19 years ago that 4 planes were hijacked. 2 of those planes flew into the North and South Towers of the World Trade Center in Lower Manhattan. One plane flew into the Pentagon, and but for the heroic efforts of the passengers of United 93, that 4th plane no doubt would have come back to Washington, D.C. and struck another target, perhaps the White House or the Capitol itself. 19 years later, we think of that day, and it will forever sear in our minds and in our memories. But as I thought about that day and as I thought about today, just all of the work that went into the original World Trade Center in building those twin towers, as well as all the other outlying buildings that make up the World Trade Center. Did you know that the groundbreaking for the original World Trade Center happened all the way back on August 5th, 1966? Just a few short months before I was even born. A long time ago. 1966. The original North Tower groundbreaking began August 1968 all the way and finished on December 23rd, 1970. The original South Tower, they began construction in January of 1969 and finished on July 19th, 1971. Well, in the aftermath of 9/11, 19 years ago, construction on the new World Trade Center began. Also known as Freedom Tower or One World Trade Center, it began in Manhattan on April 27, 2006. On May 10, 2013, the final component of the skyscraper spire was installed, making the building, including its spire, reach a total height of, anybody know? You won't forget this after today. 1,776 feet. Huh. It was actually built to that height in memory of the signing of the Declaration of Independence, making the One World Trade Center the highest structure in New York City. Now, the building opened on November 3rd, 2014, 13 years after the original World Trade Center towers were destroyed. It took a long time to rebuild what the enemy tore down. Folks, as we continue in the book of Nehemiah, if you were with us last week, we saw that in a record 52 days, Nehemiah and the people of Jerusalem were able to rebuild what the Babylonians had originally destroyed. The temple had already been rebuilt with Ezra and others who had come before Nehemiah. Nehemiah finished building the walls around Jerusalem so that they could worship in safety. 52 days. Think about that. What an amazing feat. But folks, building the temple itself, and even building the walls around the city of Jerusalem, folks, was not an end in itself. It was really just a beginning to rebuild the community of faith there in that city. And folks, even as the enemy today would love nothing more than to destroy churches, and we're seeing this even with COVID-19 play itself out and so many churches struggling in the midst of this pandemic. Folks, but we know and understand that we have one who is greater, who lives and works in and through us than the one who is in the world today. And folks, God wants to continue to rebuild his church, rebuild his people. And that happens through what we'll see this morning of the four P's. The four P's. You say, the four P's, what are the four P's, Pastor? It's just a way for me to alliterate the sermon so that you can maybe remember what it will take for you and me here at First Baptist Church Carlsbad, or maybe you're visiting this morning, maybe your church is somewhere else, for you to be a part of rebuilding the spiritual community even as the enemy still tries to tear it down. If you have your copy of God's Word, I invite you to stand with us, if you're able to stand, as we read from Nehemiah chapter 7, verses 1 through 6. And you can read the rest this afternoon. When the wall had been rebuilt, and I had the doors installed, the gatekeepers, singers, and Levites were appointed. Isn't that wonderful to know that singers were some of the first ones to be appointed so that they could help lead in worship? Then I put my brother Hananiah in charge of Jerusalem, along with Hananiah, commander of the fortress, because he was a faithful man who feared God more than most. I said to them, "Do not open the gates of Jerusalem until the sun is hot, and let the doors be shut and securely fastened while the guards are on duty. Station the citizens of Jerusalem as guards, some at their post and some at their homes." Folks, the enemy was still trying to destroy what had been rebuilt. Folks, the enemy never takes a break. But folks, I want you to know this morning that our God never takes a break either. Psalm 121, our God does not sleep, he does not slumber, he does not turn away, but he is always focused on us, his church and his children. Verse 4, the city was large and spacious, speaking of Jerusalem, but there were few people in it, and no houses had been built yet. Then my God put it into my mind to assemble the nobles, the officials, and the people to be registered by genealogy. I found the genealogical record of those who came back first, and I found the following written in it. These are the people of the province who went up among the captive exiles deported by King Nebuchadnezzar of Babylon. Each of them returned to Jerusalem and Judah to his own town. Father, we thank you this morning for your word. We thank you for Nehemiah and not only his work in rebuilding and the walls around the city, but ultimately his work in helping to rebuild a community of faith and a community of praise there in Jerusalem. Father, I pray this morning that you would help continue to rebuild even this church and the churches in our community, in our state, our nation, and our world, into churches and communities of praise to you, and temples that the Holy Spirit has taken up residence in, that we might continue to proclaim the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ, that we might, until that glorious day comes, continue to work to share the life-transforming message of Jesus Christ. Father, I pray this morning as you open our hearts and minds that we would be receptive to your word, that we would not simply hear it, but we would put it into practice here in this church, in our lives, in our families, and in this community. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Folks, the question simply this morning is, what will it take to rebuild community? What will it take to rebuild a community of faith? Four P's. We start with the first P, and that's the right place. That's the right place. In Nehemiah's day, the right place was in Jerusalem. That's where the temple centered. But folks, we understand that God is everywhere and can be worshipped everywhere. But Nehemiah was called back from Susa to go to Jerusalem. Nehemiah had a good gig in Susa. He was the cupbearer to the king, King Artaxerxes of Persia. The Persians had conquered the Babylonians. And now Nehemiah was cupbearer to the king. That was a pretty good gig. He was trustworthy. He was loyal. He probably had a pretty good lifestyle, even for a servant of the king, because the king wanted to trust Nehemiah with his very life. But yet one day, Hananiah, Nehemiah's brothers, and some other men from Jerusalem came to Susa and said, God has a mission for you. God has a different place for you to be. It was here in Susa up to this moment, but now it's a different place for you to be. And for Nehemiah, the right place was going to be Jerusalem, and in a record 52 days after his return, they would rebuild the walls of the city. And Jerusalem was large and spacious, as verse 4 tells us, but there were few people in it. No houses had been built yet. Folks, they needed to rebuild the walls of the city in order for people that were outside of Jerusalem to come and to repopulate that city. But Jerusalem for Nehemiah was the right place. Folks, the early church, it may not have been Jerusalem, but it spread out from Jerusalem and went to really all around Asia Minor and Europe. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 2, the Apostle Paul, very much as he did all of his letters, would write this, to the church of God at Corinth. Don't miss that. The church of God at Corinth. Wasn't at Jerusalem anymore. It was now at Corinth, to those sanctified in Christ Jesus, called as saints, with those in every place who call on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, both their Lord and ours. Now, where were those every places? They were in Rome. It was in Corinth. It was in Galatia. It was in Ephesus. It was in Philadelphia. It was in Sardis. It was in Thessalonica. It was in Philippi. It was all over Asia Minor and the European world. It began to spread to every place where they called on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. You know where every place is today? Right here. This is one of those every places. They didn't know that there would be a Carlsbad. They didn't know there would be a New Mexico. They didn't know that there would be a United States of America. But 2,000 years ago, when the Apostle Paul wrote that verse on the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, they knew that 2,000 years later, there would be an every place, and one of those every places would be Carlsbad, New Mexico. Folks, this is the right place. And if God has called you here, this is the right place. Whether you've been here for just a few months, whether you've been here for a few years, whether you've been here generationally, your parents and your grandparents have been here, and you've been here for 50, 60, 70 years, folks, today, right now, right here, this is the right place. If God has called you to be here, then he has called you to work until Jesus comes. He has called you to serve him, as we'll see here in just a moment. He's called you to plant your life here. Most I have just about every Sunday, someone will ask me, Pastor, do you regret moving to Carlsbad? Do you regret moving to New Mexico and knowing all that you know and all the things that have happened? Man, it's been a challenge, I will tell you, for everyone, not just your pastoral staff, not just the staff here, not just the church. Everyone has had a challenge and a struggle because of COVID-19 over the last 6 months. But I'll tell you this. And Brenda and I, from very early on in our ministry, said that wherever we were, that's exactly where we wanted to be. Folks, this is the right place. If God has called you here, and he's called you here to serve and to use your gifts and talents for his honor and for his glory, and as long as you're able to serve, this is the right place. And if this isn't the right place, God wants you to serve. And God will give you a word of whether this is the right place or maybe somewhere else is the right place. I would hope everybody would say First Baptist Carlsbad is the right place, but I know that that's simply not the reality. But folks, if you're here, be here. If you're here, be present, not just physically, but be present spiritually. Be present to serve him with your gifts and talents. Folks, the four P's, it takes, first of all, the right place. Ask yourself this morning, is First Baptist Carlsbad, New Mexico? I know some of you are from out of town and some of you are visiting and you've got a church home already. When you go back there, make sure, God, is this the right place that I'm supposed to be? Is this where I'm supposed to be, the right place, First Baptist Church of Carlsbad, New Mexico? But folks, once you get to the right place, the second P this morning, it takes the right people. It takes the right people. Look back in chapter 7 and verse 2. Then I put my brother Hananiah in charge of Jerusalem, along with Hananiah, commander of the fortress, because he was a faithful man who feared God more than most. You see, it needed the right leaders, and for Jerusalem, it was Hananiah and Hananiah. But it was not just the Hananiah and Hananiah, it was the gatekeepers, the singers, and the Levites that Nehemiah would appoint. It took the right leaders in the right place. And it took the right citizens to come back, and they would begin to rebuild. They would rebuild not just the walls, they have already rebuilt the temple, but they would begin to rebuild actually their homes, that they might live there, that they might be planted there, that they might grow there where God had called them to live. For when he calls you to the right place, he calls you to set down roots and to grow and to live. And by the way, folks, we don't know how long that is. Man, it could be a few years. It could be some of you are here and you've been here for 50, 60, 70 years. And you go, man, it's a long time. When I served over in Alamogordo, we were near an Air Force base. And we had folks that came in and came out. And they're like, well, you know, Pastor, I don't know if I want to join the church because we might get transferred. That's all right. God knows where you get transferred. You might be here with the oil fields. You might be working out of the oil fields. You say, I'm not sure how long I'm going to be. That's all right. God knows how long you're going to be here. Plant your life here as long as you're here. And when God tells you it's time to go, it's time to go. You go. But as long as you're here, plant your life here because this is the right place. And if you're here, you're the right person. You're the right people. It takes the right leaders. It takes the right citizens. In Nehemiah today, it takes the right people who are called to be part of the body of Christ. Ephesians chapter 4, verses 11 through 13. The Apostle Paul writes, he himself, speaking of Jesus, gave some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers, equipping the saints for the work of ministry, to build up the body of Christ until we all reach unity in the faith and the knowledge of God's Son, growing into maturity with a stature measured by God's fullness. Folks, today, in the right place, it takes the right people. It takes the right leaders, whether it's pastors and deacons, the two biblical offices that God has called. And so I'm so thankful that even in the midst of COVID-19, even when a lot of churches were just kind of shutting down everything that they were doing, that's exactly when God ramped up our student and singles pastor search and led us to Pastor Michael. And he's here today because God is faithful and God called he and Emily, his family, to be here as part of this church. He's been here for 2 months, maybe. Pastor Kevin, where's Kevin? He's up in the sound booth. I always forget, and he sneaks back around to the sound booth. He's been here 27, 28 years. Wow. That in and of itself is amazing. Most pastors, particularly those that are not senior pastors, do not last in one church 27, 28 years. That is a blessing to be sure that God called he and Amy here all those years ago, and God still has them here for such a time as this and for work to do. Pastor Gary to come in about 2012 for such a time as this. All of our support staff that work in the office, and we are so blessed to have who we have working in our church office, and I know that you pray for all of us daily. Folks, it takes the right place and it takes the right people, the right leadership, but it also takes others to do the work of ministry, to teach Sunday school, Bible study. We still have a couple spots that we need filled for next week. Man, we're excited, and I heard that applause. We're excited about getting back to what I'm going to call a more normal schedule next week. It's not new normal, but a more normal schedule next week. So I encourage you to come. Be here in your spot. If this is your normal time, or if you want to come 8:15, great, get here early. Invite somebody to come with you. We've got plenty of space to spread out here in the worship center at 8:15 and 10:45, and to find your spot in Bible study. But we need people to teach. We need people to teach Sunday school, whether it's to children and preschool and our nursery. And those ladies do a fantastic job to teach our students, to teach our adults from our young adults all the way up to our senior adults, to teach men's and women's Bible study. And I don't know about you ladies, I'm probably going to sneak in and just get a little sneak peek of what's happening with the Sermon on the Mount. If you've not signed up for that yet, man, I would encourage you to sign up for that. Tuesdays at 9:30, Thursdays at 6:30. You got two opportunities. Tuesday mornings, if you've got children, we've got childcare available. That's going to be a great time. But we need women's Bible study teachers. We need men's Bible study teachers to be able to do that, to do the work of ministry in all phases of our ministry, from our littlest ones all the way up to our senior adults, to work with our benevolence and our bereavement. Our Wednesday night meals, man, aren't those good? If you've missed our Wednesday night meals, you've missed a treat, so you need to make sure you get RSVP'd if you're not already doing that. But we need extra people just to fill up cups with tea or with water to hand out. We need extra folks, so just if you can do it once a month, we would love to have you. There's places where you can serve. Disaster relief, hey guys, you're still watching, hopefully you are. They're on the road now as we speak, heading to Louisiana, another team that we've sent out for disaster relief to be able to serve and to do the work of ministry. And choirs and singers, even as Nehemiah appointed singers early on. Instrumentalists, praise band, praise team. I don't know about you, would you? I just love how Pastor Kevin and the praise team just lead us in worship every single Sunday. Would you give the Lord a hand for them and their dedication to us? But you know, it really wouldn't be that great if you couldn't hear us. So audiovisual, God, thank you so much, ladies and gentlemen, for all that you do. Usually, we never look that way unless we're hearing something. Thank you so much for your dedication, your faithfulness week in and week out. You give the Lord a hand for those guys. Thank you so much. You know, with COVID-19, we're expanding our ministry and our online presence. We've got new cameras that we're going to get in, and so we need people to operate those cameras. So maybe that's you, and you would love to be a part of that. We're renovating the belfry up here for a video room, and so maybe you would like to, even if not every week, maybe once a month, you'd like to participate in running our cameras. So we've got lots of opportunities to do the work of ministry. Why? Ultimately, that we do that so we all reach unity in the faith and the knowledge of God's Son. Folks, if you are here and First Baptist Church is where you call home, then this is where you need to be. And this is where you need to plug in, and this is the right place, and you are the right people for this time. But third this morning, we can be in the right place. We can even be the right people teaching and preaching and serving and doing the work of ministry. But folks, if we do not have the right pedigree, we do not have the right pedigree, then it doesn't really matter. When I talk about pedigree, I'm talking about lineage. I'm talking about identity. You know, anybody like to go on Ancestry.com or any of those sort of genealogical websites? I kind of find it fascinating. And several years ago, I kind of started doing a little bit deeper dive. And I always kind of knew with my last name is Scott that I was probably Scots-Irish in English, and then my grandmother on my mother's side is a Fritz, so I figure there's probably a little German thrown in there. But you know, one of the weird things is my dad's family, part of them had migrated from Vermont. They were from Vermont down to Florida, and we always like, Vermont? How did they get from Vermont down to Florida? That's kind of weird. And I began to do some research to find out that my grandmother, Julia, was originally born in Quebec. And so I have French as well as English and German, but I didn't know that until I started tracing my lineage and my family tree to find out how all of this came about. We know Nehemiah, as he was rebuilding the community of Jerusalem, was going to need to populate it with people from a Jewish background. You can go back, and these names here I didn't read, but beginning in verse 8 of chapter 7 all the way through verse 59, it is a list, a genealogical list, and the Jewish people that were just impeccable in keeping genealogical records. We see that even in the New Testament. As we go all the way back to the lineage of Jesus, both in Matthew and in Luke, they were impeccable in keeping that. But if you weren't on the list, that became a problem. Look in verse 61. The following are those who came from Telmelah, Telharsha, Cherub, Adon, and Emir, but were unable to prove that their ancestral families and their lineage were Israelite. He goes on, and that even some priests that were disqualified because they searched the genealogical records. These folks came up and said, okay, we're here, we're ready to move back into Jerusalem, are we on the list? And they looked at the list, said, you're not on the list. You don't have the right pedigree. You don't have the right lineage. And just because you self-identify as part of the people of Israel, you're not on the list. That doesn't count. Folks, understand that still goes on today. A lot of people self-identify as something. I had a professor, not my professor, but at George Washington University, Just a couple weeks ago, they announced that my alma mater in Washington, D.C., that a longtime professor, I think she has been there for about 20, 30 years, who self-identified as African-American, and finally came out and said, no, I really am not African-American, I'm Anglo. And we see that all the time in politics, do we not, that certain politicians identify as one thing but are simply something else. And by the way, folks, you can have biological males identify as female or biological females identify as male, but that does not make it so. In the beginning, God created them male and female. Folks, understand, just because we self-identify as something that we're not, some people, I think I just saw somebody self-identified as a deer, as a cat. I mean, you would be amazed at what people self-identify. Just because they self-identify as something does not make it so. Folks, why I spend time on that this morning, simply this, that you can have the right intent but the wrong pedigree. Once you have the right intent but the wrong pedigree, folks, you can be born into a Christian family. And I'm blessed to have been born into a Christian family. If you were born into a Christian family, folks, that's a blessing. If you came to faith in Christ later on and maybe you didn't have that Christian upbringing, that's a blessing as well. But it's a blessing to be sure to be born into a Christian family. But just being born into a Christian family does not give you the right pedigree. Folks, you can be a member of the church. And as wonderful as church membership is, as wonderful as being a part of First Baptist Church in Carlsbad, New Mexico, it is just being a church member is not sufficient for the right pedigree. We had a wonderful baptism this morning. As Todd came to the baptismal waters, I will tell you, when I was 10, I went into the baptismal waters at First Baptist Church in Lake Placid, Florida, and I got wet because I didn't have Jesus Christ as my Savior and Lord. I'd never been born again. So I got dunked under the water and I got wet, but I was not baptized. Baptism, as wonderful as it is, that first step of obedience in the Christian life, folks, in and of itself is not sufficient for the right pedigree. Serving in the church, as good as that is, whether it's a pastor, a deacon, a Sunday school teacher, working with our students and our children, and serving in the church, as wonderful as that is, and we're going to have service opportunities Sunday in just a minute where you can find out ways that you can serve or pray for those who are serving. As good as serving in the church is, that simply is not sufficient for the right pedigree. Giving of your tithes and offerings, as wonderful as that is, and we'll talk about that in a moment as well, giving financially to the support of the church, as wonderful as that is, simply is not sufficient for the right pedigree. There's only one who will make you sufficient for the right pedigree, and that's Jesus Christ. By grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone is the only way that you and I could ever have the right pedigree, the right lineage, and that's to be born again in and through Jesus Christ. 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 through 5, Peter reminds us, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, because of his great mercy he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you. You are being guarded by God's power through faith for a salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last time." Folks, understand this morning that even in the Old Testament, Rahab and Ruth would testify to the fact that it wasn't about their outward lineage, but it was about their inward transformation and their inward heart. And the Apostle Paul in Romans chapter 2 reminds us that those who are Jews are not Jews outwardly, but inwardly the circumcision is that of the heart, that we have been born again, born from above, and changed by the Holy Spirit of God. Folks, if you want to have the right pedigree, even if you're the right person in the right place, folks, it is all for naught if you do not have the right pedigree, and that is only in and through faith in Jesus Christ and Christ alone. For some of you today is the day to receive that right pedigree. Today is the day to receive that right lineage. Today is the day that you repent and believe Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord. For without that, you will not see heaven. Jesus Christ is the only way into heaven. His is the only lineage, his is the only pedigree that will get anyone into that very real place called heaven. Do you have it? Are you sure that you're sure that you're sure? Before you leave here this morning, make sure you know that you have the right pedigree, that you're not relying on anything else but relying on Jesus Christ and Christ alone. That gets us to the fourth P, and that's the right participation. The right participation. You see, in Nehemiah's day, that project had come together in 52 days, and even before, as Nehemiah was getting all of the supplies together, that took not just manpower as they worked on the wall, but folks, that took financial resources that everyone gave to the project, beginning with Nehemiah himself. Verse 70. Some of the family heads contributed to the project. The governor, and who's the governor? The governor, as we saw just a couple of weeks ago, in good governor, bad governor, the governor is none other than Nehemiah himself. So the governor gave 1,000 gold coins, 50 bowls, 530 priestly garments to the treasury. Some of the family heads gave 20,000 gold coins and 2,200 silver minas to the treasury for the project. The project, again, is rebuilding the walls of the city. The rest of the people, again, everybody participated, not just the governor, not just Nehemiah, not just the other leaders, but the rest of the people gave 20,000 gold coins, 2,000 silver minas, and 67 priestly garments. Folks, God is calling us to participate with our gifts and with our talents and to spiritually serve Him. But folks, God is also calling us to invest not just our lives, but He is calling us to invest financially our tithes and offerings into the mission and ministry of the local New Testament church. And if your church home is First Baptist Church of Carlsbad, New Mexico, then this is where God wants you to invest your life and wants to invest your tithes and your offerings as we give, not just for our missions and ministry, but as we give for Mission New Mexico, as we give for Lottie Moon, for international missions coming up, as we give for Annie Armstrong and North American missions, as we will give for disaster relief. And right now on the field, folks are serving from this church. But folks, it takes all of us, not equal gifts, because we'll not be able to give equally. But it does take all of us giving equal sacrifice, sacrificial giving for what God has entrusted to us. And folks, God has blessed this church for 130 years here in this community to be able to share the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. This is the right place. This is the right people for such a time as this, with the right pedigree. And God is calling us to right participation today. Folks, what will it take to rebuild the community of faith, even as the enemy tries to destroy it? Even as we know that we'll have challenges in the days ahead, even as we reopen all of our other ministries on Sunday, next Sunday, we know that there will be challenges, to be sure. What's it going to take to be able to rebuild the spiritual community, not just of First Baptist Church, Carlsbad, New Mexico, but every other church in this community, in this state, in this nation, in this world, that we might be able, until Jesus comes, until that glorious day that He comes again, that we might be able to continue the work that He's given us to do? What will it take? It'll take you. 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 It'll take me. It'll take all of us. Not just a few of us. Not just 10% doing 90% of the work, but it will take each and every one of us doing what God has called us to do. He's called us not to sit, but He's called us to serve. And today is a day of service. Not tomorrow, not next week, because we don't know that we'll even have that, but today, right now, is a day to serve Him. And it will take you and it will take me in the right place, with the right people, with the right pedigree, as we all rightly participate in the greatest mission that God has ever given the world, and that's to go make disciples, to lift up the name of Jesus, to love Him, and to love our neighbor as ourselves, to fulfill the Great Commission, and to live out the Great Commandment right here at First Baptist Church of Carlsbad, New Mexico. Are you willing to do what God has called each of us to do today? Let's pray. Father God, thank You this morning for Your blessings that You have given to this church over 130 years. Continue to bless this church with people that You have brought here, the right people in the right place with the right pedigree to rightly participate in Your mission and Your work. Father, I pray this morning, if there's anyone here who is never turned from sin and self and turned to Jesus Christ in repentance and faith, They've never been born again. They've never been born from above. They don't know the lineage of Jesus Christ because they've never received that new creation in Christ. Father, I pray today that your Holy Spirit would open their hearts and minds to draw them to the cross, to the empty tomb, that they might be saved today. For Christians this morning who are part of First Baptist Church of Carlsbad, New Mexico, that they might just reaffirm that this is the right place that you have called them and that they will be a people who will participate through faith in Jesus Christ for His honor and for His glory. And Father, help us to continue to reach out to this community and ultimately to this world with the gospel of Jesus Christ, the good news that we proclaim. And Father, I pray your blessings upon this church. Continue to expand our territory, our boundaries, our influence. Walk with us each and every day as you promised to do. Emmanuel, God, with us. Keep us from harm and from pain as we reach our community. Father, as your Spirit moves this morning, might we focus upon Jesus Christ. Might He be the center, even in these moments today as we are renewed in the opportunities that we have, wherever our feet might take us this week. For we ask all this in Jesus' precious name and for His sake. Amen. As we stand together, as we sing, the altars are open. Maybe you simply need to come and pray and say, God, I want to be the man or woman, the teenager, the child. I want to be that person that uses my gifts and talents to serve you. Maybe this morning you simply need to come as a family, maybe as a couple, and say, God, we want to be all in for you here at First Baptist Church of Carlsbad, New Mexico. Maybe you're here this morning, you've never trusted Christ, and today is the day that God draws you to the cross, to the empty tomb for salvation. As we sing, Jesus, be the center, you come this morning.
Be the reason.
bowed and eyes closed for just a few moments as we continue this invitation. If God is speaking to you as our instrumentalists continue to play, you come on this morning.
Be my source, be my light, Jesus.
Be seated for just a moment. Wow. Good to be in the house of the Lord this morning. Amen?
Amen.
Well, it is always a wonderful way to begin a service with baptism. And Todd, I want to present you with this certificate of baptism. It certifies that Todd Sterling Hayden was baptized on the 13th day of September in the year of our Lord, 2020. And he's coming. Robin is already a member here, and his family were able to be here from out of town. God bless you. Thank you so much for standing here this morning. If you rejoice with Todd, let it be known by saying amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Y'all can be seated. And they're going to be out in the foyer as you go out this morning, and because that's where everybody's going to be heading that way, to the fellowship hall in just a minute. So you share with them. You'll be praying for them. Let me start here with Corinne Bradford. You come on up. And Maddie, you come stand with her. Maddie's friend, Corinne, and she's coming this morning. Wanted to just talk about church membership. And so I'm going to get a chance to visit with her about spiritual things, about salvation in Jesus Christ and church membership. But she's wanted to come and just sensing God, wanted to be a part of what's going on here at First Baptist. So if you rejoice with Corinne this morning, let it be known by saying amen.
Amen.
God bless you. And she'll be out there too, so you come, let her know. You'll be praying for her. All right, Jimmy and Anna Tarvin, you come. And Miss Pat, if you want to stay seated, or you can stand up, either way. And this is Anna's mom, Pat. And so Jimmy retired not too long ago as a pastor out at Loving. And so they've been worshiping with us here for a couple months now, and just sensing that God wants them to be a part of what he's doing here at First Baptist Church Carlsbad. And we rejoice with them coming by transfer of letter from Loving. So if you rejoice with the Tarvins and Miss Pat coming this morning, would you let it be known by saying amen?
Amen.
Amen. God bless you. Wow. Amen. Well, I'm going to go ahead, and all of you guys, if you want to go ahead and step right on out to the foyer as we get ready to dismiss. We've got our service opportunity Sunday that's still going on. We've got booths, tables in the fellowship hall with our ministries where we need not just help, but we need your prayers. And so even if you can't participate in those ministries, you can be praying, first of all, for the Lord of the harvest to raise up workers to be going out into some of those areas that we still need work in, or you yourself might be one of those workers that God's raising up to volunteer to be a part of his ministry. As we move forward, folks, we move forward together with the Lord, and God's got, and I believe, the best days of First Baptist Church are yet still out in front of us. And so it's the right place with the right people, the right pedigree, and might we be right in our participation in all that God has for us to do. We're going to dismiss in a word of prayer, and then usually you go out those back doors. We're going to ask you to come right out these doors, right down the hall, into the fellowship hall. We've got even some candy, I think, on a couple of the tables. So, I mean, I can't entice you more than that. So you come on as Pastor Gary finishes it out today.
Many times you say, well, it takes a lot of people to make ministry all happen at First Baptist. And you'd be right. But just think about it. When you're coming back off of COVID, reopening, it takes more people than it did before because we do check-in for children. We do a lot of different things that we didn't do regularly. So when you're over in the service opportunity Sunday, over in the fellowship hall, there's places to sign up to help us check in kids. And that might take 20, 30 minutes some Sundays. But check it all out. There's a lot of opportunities that you could have to serve our Lord. Let's pray. Father, we just thank you for the challenge we received today, and we just ask that you help us each to examine that calling that you have upon our lives, that we might answer the call and be an active part of ministry here through our church. And Lord, as we leave this place today, may we all remember that we just